Ever since the first airplane took the skies in the early 20th century, succeeding models have all usually shared something in common: symmetry. Going against this philosophy would seem to go against common sense. In 1979, however, renowned aeronautical engineer Robert Thomas Jones defied this very basic aircraft design principle with the NASA AD-1. The unusual airframe was made of fiberglass and plastic, with two small turbojet engines. However, its real innovation was that its wing could be pivoted obliquely from 0 to 60 degrees mid-flight, just like a blade on a pair of scissors. A German innovation. Lifting wings have long been thought of as being optimized for one of two things: lift, for taking off and landing, or speed, with aerodynamic efficiency. These configurations are translated into modern aircraft that typically need to choose one or the other. Perpendicular wings provide maximum lift, while swept wings sacrifice this attribute in favor of efficiency at supersonic speeds. It's also been thought that a variable oblique wing could be slanted forward on one side of the aircraft to bring together the best of both philosophies. Swept wing designs were proposed by German engineers as early as 1935, but it wasn't until 1942 that Richard Vogt from the German plane manufacturer Blohm & Voss actually created the blueprint for an aircraft with an oblique wing. Vogt's P-202 jet fighter was designed to experiment with the idea of a scissor wing, in which one side could pivot forward and the other one back once in flight. While intriguing on paper, a test model was never built before the end of the Second World War in 1945, and Vogt moved back to the United States to work on other projects. America pivots to a new idea. Simultaneously, Robert T. Jones, an aeronautical engineer at the National Advisory Committee for Aeronautics Ames Research Center in California, also came up with a similar idea and attempted to further develop it. Like Vogt, he also believed that a plane with an oblique wing could fly effectively. Jones's early innovative concept for aircraft development did not appear to be influenced by the Germans. Instead, Jones was working at the NACA's Langley Aeronautical Laboratory during World War II, when he noticed that as planes became faster and more powerful, aerodynamic problems arose when pilots approached Mach 1 speed. Faster airflow over the wings generated shockwaves that increased drag and reduced lift. Based on these observations, Jones concluded that by abandoning the conventional straight wing perpendicular to the fuselage, aircraft performance at high speeds would improve. He believed that sweeping at least one wing back toward the tail would reduce drag and increase transonic speeds. With the wingtips moved rearward, the shockwaves produced past Mach 1 could be delayed, allowing the aircraft to fly more effectively. When Jones issued his oblique wing concept paper to his superiors, it was firmly rejected as being too complicated and impractical. It would not be until the end of the war, after he heard about the German ideas for the oblique wing design, that he decided to continue with his project. Further research conducted by Jones suggested that oblique wing aircraft could be twice as fuel efficient as a straight wing design, resulting in increased range, reduced gross takeoff weight, and reduced takeoff noise. In a published paper, Jones wrote, quote, "Artifacts created by humans show a nearly irresistible tendency for bilateral symmetry." When his colleagues pointed out to him that there were no birds with oblique wings, Jones replied that it was because they could not fly at supersonic speeds. Jones would continue to work on the project until the late 1950s, when his investigations sparked interest among other personnel involved in helping aircraft reach speeds beyond Mach 1. In 1958, supersonic wind tunnel tests conducted at the Ames Research Center, now part of NASA, finally proved that the oblique wing was much more efficient than the conventional wing at supersonic speeds. However, it wasn't until the 1970s that Jones would be able to restart his project and begin designing a low-cost experimental aircraft for flight testing. The prototype was designated NASA Ames Dryden 1, or AD-1, as part of a joint program between NASA and Boeing Commercial Airplane Company. It was based on an oblique wing transport plane by Boeing, built by Ames Industrial Company of upstate New York for under $250,000. The prototype arrived at NASA Dryden in February 1979. The NASA AD-1. Even though Jones's research suggested that an oblique wing could be permanently fixed at a specific angle, the AD-1 prototype used a wing that was pivoted by an electrically driven gear mechanism located inside the fuselage. This decision was made to approach tests with different configurations. A switch on the instrument panel initiated the wing sweep. It was later returned to its default position of a perpendicular angle by the same switch or by the pilot's center control stick. The jet was small compared to other U.S. fighter aircraft. It was just over 38 feet long, with an unswept wingspan of 32 feet. It had a weight of 2,100 pounds. The lightweight fiberglass and reinforced plastic structure gave the AD-1 a unique look that made it stand out. A fixed tricycle landing gear was mounted near the fuselage to diminish aerodynamic drag. The AD-1 had a squatty appearance, as it was only 6.75 feet high from the ground. It also featured a conventional rudder and horizontal stabilizer. The plane was powered by two small micro-turbo TRS-18046 turbojet engines that produced 220 pounds of static thrust at sea level. They were mounted on short pylons at the fuselage midpoint. For safety purposes, speed was limited to about 170 miles per hour, although the AD-1 could reach a top speed of 200 miles per hour. Takeoff speed was about 97 miles per hour, with the best rate of climb between 126 and 138 miles per hour. The touchdown speed was 92 miles per hour. Since the prototype was designed with the sole purpose of testing the oblique wing design, it lacked any type of armament and other instrument panel essentials for aerial combat. It also didn't go supersonic. The Flying Scissor. The main goals of the AD-1 program were to evaluate the flying qualities of an oblique wing aircraft, investigate its control system requirements, and compare data obtained during the research project with information gained during earlier wind tunnel tests on scaled models from years before. The low cost of the program limited the depth of technical research that could be carried out. Still, it produced enough information on the small prototype's flying qualities and aerodynamics to show the possible capabilities of a larger version. Before the flight testing, the aircraft had to undergo some safety examinations. The AD-1 had to pass a ground vibration and a loading test. The wing loads test's purpose was to check wing deflection and obtain a calibration of the root bending moment strain gauges for symmetrical loads. Results showed that the wing was 15% stiffer in bending than what was indicated by the design. For the ground vibration test, the plane was suspended from an I-beam through an airbag system connected to a rigid plate attached to the wing pivot. A shaker was then attached to both sides of the wing. Accelerometers were used to sense the responses from various components of the aircraft. Several sweep angles were used for the tests, which ultimately gave the go for the flight tests. The NASA AD-1 made its maiden flight on December 21, 1979, at Edwards Air Force Base in California. This first flight was done under the conventional perpendicular wing angle at 0 degrees. From that date on, future flights would begin by increasing the wing's angle by 15, 20, 35, and 45 degrees, until it was able to reach the full 60-degree angle on August 7, 1982. It made history as the first flight of an oblique wing plane. The AD-1 would complete a total of 79 flights with 17 different pilots, two of them being the NASA program pilots, Fitzhugh L. Fulton and Thomas C. McMurtry, who made the first flight. During the earliest flights, the overall performance of the AD-1 was evaluated. This included stability and handling qualities before proceeding to an increase of the wing angle. Overall, the aircraft behaved exactly as Jones had predicted in his research and experimentation. The problems that did pop up were minor, such as reduced lateral stability and oscillation at certain angles, especially when maneuvering at the full 60 degrees. Most of the testing was conducted at an altitude of 12,500 feet. Most test pilots agreed that the AD-1 became unstable above 50 degrees. Although the aircraft could still be piloted successfully in that configuration, the pitch roll effects and handling control difficulties still made it challenging. A NASA guest pilot, Warren Hall, said, quote, "Takeoff and landing, you just did it. You didn't think about it. Because you worked your way up from 10 to 60, you learned real quick to go left and right, going whichever way you want to go, up and down, and there wasn't any problem at all. There wasn't anything that said, hey, this is a bad flying airplane. I would have liked to put it in my pocket and bring it home." The NASA AD-1 had its final flight at Oshkosh, Wisconsin on August 7, 1982, during the Experimental Aircraft Association annual show. After this last public presentation, it was returned to NASA Dryden. It was stored and later put up for display at the Heller Aviation Museum in San Carlos, California. Legacy. The NASA AD-1 was flown a total of 79 times. It performed well under every flight. The unique design created by Jones proved a critical point, that an aircraft with an unconventional configuration, such as the oblique wing, could perform better than a traditional plane at Mach 1 speeds. Its design, components, and rare innovations made the AD-1 a one-of-a-kind aircraft that laid the foundation for swept-wing designs that continue to be implemented to this day.